Augustyn, ex-professional road bike rider. I'll tell you a little bit about my story. Yeah, so how it started was my dad obviously rode bikes, and he's a very adventurous guy. And that's how it started. We just like to ride the bicycles from a very young age. So my dad bought us a mountain bike, obviously. A very small one, and we just like to ride around with my brother and my cousin. It was always us riding around, and slowly my dad obviously did the mountain bike races, so we came together, and that's how it started. I mean, we did the jumps and the wheelies and all that kind of stuff, and slowly progressed, and then from there my dad obviously saw that we've got a bit of talent. My brother's more into the more aggressiveness, I was a bit more in the endurance riding. And that's how we started riding. And then with the local bike shop, the guy said, well, why don't you just we give him a road bike and we see what he can do. So that was about the age of 14, and I did my very first South African championships, and I got second. So that's where it all started. Everybody saw there's some talent, and my dad asked me, do you really want to do this? And I said yes, I want to be a pro. Yeah, so my dad, he bought his, he bought the nice mountain bikes that he wanted to buy, and we steal little bits off, and by the time he gets to the bike, there's no more left, and we've got the frame, the brakes and everything. I remember the very first mountain bike was a big old 26 steel frame Hansen bike, no suspension, just a few gears, and we were over the moon with a new bike. But obviously that time, with a passion, it's much more about just riding. We don't really care, like, you've got this bike, you've got that suspension. And so it was mainly about the passion and just riding. Just we wanted to ride every day. The way I got to Europe was, I was the last year of school. I got a guy in South Africa that would have had a team, a sort of local team. After that year of winning almost all the junior races and dominating, they gave me an opportunity to go do some classic races, junior classic races in Belgium. So with all the money that I've saved from races, I bought a ticket, went to Belgium, and the very first race was Liège-Bastogne-Liège for juniors, and I got third. And that's when they saw, good, we gave you a contract. So I already had a contract, I was still in school, so I finished school and went straight to Europe. It was hard, didn't know the language, didn't know where to go, obviously very young, but I was very motivated. It was quite nice to be in a new culture, finally be in Europe where the whole all the cycling happens. So from then we did a lot of classics in Belgium, France, Spain. We went to Japan. Won the mountains jersey in Japan, and the following year I got second in Japan in the mountains jersey as well. And then Barloworld got hold of me, flew me to Italy. Immediately fell in love with Italy. It changed my life. I mean, so obviously everybody sees the nice side of cycling. Oh, you're so lucky, you're a pro. But no one knows the suffering the guys put in. Really, really suffering. I come from not a very wealthy family, so we really had to work very hard for what we wanted. So that gave me an extra motivation, extra sort of push to get to the top. That's all I had. So in Belgium, we had to fight every day. We got very little salary, so you can only buy a certain amount of food. Obviously, you get the good days, your bad days, where you cry on the bike as well, really suffer, and you think, oh, this, it's not worth it. But then you carry on, and then the next race goes better, and it sort of gets you forward. But obviously, the very difficult part for cyclists is getting a new contract. That is most probably the worst part. You're not sure, geez, am I going to get the team, what am I going to do? But obviously, I mean, you have to work hard. So that's when some teams were after me. But then you have to make the right decision. So my right decision was to go to Italy. I loved the culture and everything. Yeah, it was very nice. But obviously, like when you step into the pro career, that's really when you have to step it up. You're riding with some of the best in the world. You're just a very young guy, so it's very emotional. But once you get into the big races, you really need to dig deep. Some days, like the suffering you go through, just have to carry on pushing. And so one thing that I can really carry through my career from when I was a young boy, when we started, my dad, he's probably one of the big roles in my career, and also my mom. It's people that's been in my life mentally pushing me very hard, because they know I really wanted so bad to be a pro. So early mornings before school, we wake up really, really early. My mom wakes me up. We go riding 20 kilometers in the dark. So those mornings were really hard. And then on the weekends, we go for a big ride, and my dad would really, really push me. That's when it's sort of like the Afrikaans, Dutch mentality comes in, like really, really dig deep. I would cry on the bike, and my legs are paining, and my legs are hurting, and my dad would just shout at me, "Come on, sit in the wheel and stop crying." So those days still coming to mind, and my mom would be at the back, "Oh, don't worry, it's not that far anymore." So it's small things that sort of goes through your mind when I do big races, when I'm suffering. You still think about those things. Stop crying, do it. So things that actually carried me through my whole sort of career. And it's just the one thing to really dig deep until you sort of faint. You see, my dad always said, ride until you can't ride anymore, until you can't see. So there's a lot of things when you ride big mountains that really, really push beyond the limit, like absolutely beyond your limit. And those are things that when I did the Tour de Portugal in 2007, I was lying third overall with about 30 seconds off of youngest rider jersey, and the last day was a time trial in the rain, so I was really, really motivated, so concentrated, I was in the skis, maybe too confident, too concentrated, and the DS shouted, "John, there's a turn." So as I saw the arrow, I would grab the brakes and just slid and fell on the leg, broke the leg. But at that stage, obviously I knew like there's something wrong. So it was very hard to sort of accept that. I was 21 years old. You were going really, really well. I was about 62 kilos, very, very light. So I was actually like sort of on the tip to start becoming a real pro. So that's when I went to the hospital. The doctor said it's a fracture on the head of the femur, 4 months on crutches. So I lost all the muscle in the one leg. So I had to do everything from scratch again, start walking, pull exercises. And then from there, in about 6 months' time, I did the Tour de France from there. So it just shows you with motivation, you can do it. Maybe sometimes we push it too hard. And then obviously, I mean, we got to the tour after that and did some good stuff in the mountains, in my happy place in the mountains. So Obviously, the big day, the famous day in the Labounette, it was good. It really went well on the end. To the top, it was all good. And then the other side crashed down. And
this is John Lee Augustyn, I think, who's gone off the edge of the road. And let's just have a look at this one more time. He's coming around that corner. He came into the corner much too fast, straight over the top of the climb. And he's onto the shale there. He's sliding down. They've stopped at the side of the road to see how he is. He seems to be okay, but he doesn't have a bike with him anymore. Well, that is very sad.
Luckily, I'm very lucky to walk away unscratched, got no injuries. But obviously, it was quite bad to crash in that descent where I could have maybe got a top four and hopefully actually win the race. But other than that, I mean, everybody remembers the crash. I'm quite famous for it. So that's when we launched the brand with the clothing. But so it's something quite nice, sort of a peak in the career, something to fall back on as well. But obviously carrying on when I had to retire, looking back now, it's quite nice to realize that I've actually done most of the big races in the world. Done all the three Grand Tours, Olympics, at the age of 26, I've done almost all the big races. So at least that's a good point. Talking a little bit more into depth about the horror crash that happened in Portugal. It's quite an interesting story. At that time, obviously, when I crashed on the leg, sliding on my back, the director, actually a very good friend of mine, she ran to me. She's actually a masseur. She was following me in the car, and she just kept on shouting, "Come on, John, you have to get up." And I just told her, like, "Listen, I can't. So there's something wrong." So then the ambulance came. They helped me up. And then we obviously realized there's something wrong. And then they took me to the hospital. We saw that there was a fracture. So that's when the doctor came to me. He didn't really speak very good English, but he just told me it's very bad. He might have to get a hip replacement a little bit later in the future, but he'll definitely start walking again. It's going to take some time to get going again and so on. I was then for about 2 weeks in Portugal in the hospital. No one speaks any English, so I was just lying in the bed. I maybe slept 1 hour a day. Too much pain, and I can't roll over. So it wasn't very nice. And then sometimes I cried myself to sleep, like my career's over and whatever. So then from there they flew me to Italy. I stayed in Italy for another month until I was a bit more stable to fly back to South Africa. I was back to my family. My parents looked after me. I was still walking around in crutches. And then I spoke to the university, Port Elizabeth in South Africa, a very good friend of mine. She's part of the rehabilitation center. She got me off the crutches, into the pool. We did a lot of pool exercises, started walking from scratch. Did a lot of lunges, squats, all the rehabilitation exercises possible to start building the muscle again. But obviously from that point, the only focus was to get back on the bicycle, to start riding again. I picked up about 7 kgs, so it's obviously for the cyclist it's quite bad. You pick up some weight and whatever, but obviously it's also good to pick up weight to get the bone growth back going. And but the main thing was really nice to be back on the bike. It was like walking again. So I started riding again with the Velez brothers. From Slovakia, so they flew down to Port Elizabeth. We trained together and did a lot of miles in over December and January. So really bonded well, nicely. Then I flew back to Europe, back to the team, back to the training camps. So the hard work started off again with all the races. So slowly building it up with all the races and all the kilometers in the legs, actually sort of got into it quite nice. And then that's when I realized that I can start racing at the top again. So that gave me extra boost. And a very good mentor that I had with me in Bollywood was Robbie Hunter. He's an ex-professional from South Africa as well. a lot of people might know him. So he was very, a very mental, a good mental point in my, in that part of my life, sort of motivating me all the time. Some of the races we went to Portugal. I think I won the climbers jersey in Portugal, back in Portugal again, and then that's when the team sort of saw, okay, he's back on it. So they put me on the big list for the Tour de France, and then I was like super motivated. So we went back, we went into the mountains, we did altitude training, dropped off all the excess weight, got back down to sort of a good climbing weight again, and then from there we did the right races to build up to the Tour. And then at that point, Claudio Corti from Bollywood phoned me and said, "Listen, John, come to my office." So I was a little bit wary what's happening. So he said, "Okay, so you're on the list for the Tour, so it's good." So that was like a really, really nice point in my career. I was 20 years old then. So for me, it was really amazing to be part of the team again. Doing a big race, my first big Tour. So it was very nice to sort of come back from the hard suffering and disappointment, my career's over, back to the top again. So carrying on after my career, when I finally made a decision to retire, I put away the bike. I wasn't very in love with the bicycle at that moment. But I do love fashion. I do love... Italy obviously is the icon of fashion, shoes, glasses, everything is just, everybody looks at that. And fashion you can also draw to cycling. So through some friends and family, I got in love with the bike again. My wife, she's a fashion designer, she makes wedding dresses and quite nice designs. So then we sort of decided, why don't we start a brand? So I started with my own clothing brand, La Bonnette. So it's got a bit of a story and history to it. So it's quite nice to sort of combine the Italian style to the cycling. The cycling is changing every day with modern fashion. So it's quite nice to sort of put back into the sport. There's the bike obviously got me from South Africa all the way to Europe. Introduced me to amazing races. I've seen amazing places. There's some places that you would never even think about that you see on your bicycle. So it's quite nice to sort of take all that in and get all the experience out, and also teach younger riders what cycling is about, and sort of mentor them into the sport. So I've had quite a lot of South African guys that I've followed last year in Europe, took them to some amazing places, and it's changed their lives. And there's some good guys that will get to the top because of seeing what the sport's about and seeing all the different cultures. So it's quite nice to sort of experience that, and just a little thing to say to the junior or younger guys, or a more, not older guys, but more advanced guys as well, just to don't stop, follow your dream. If you're suffering, just carry on and you'll get better.
That's how I see you. When I see you from below, and I feel no other, it's a sound.